I'm like, come and put that pussy on me. Don't be running from me. If I like it, I spend money on it. Get whatever from me. Put six figures in your business. I do real shit. I drop cash at the dealership. They'll mail your pink slip. She makes sure she.
Okay, what's up, everybody? My name is Yavi, and I'm about to talk to you guys about my trip to Dominican Republic. My surgeon was Dr. Cabral. I went on April 15th, that was my surgery date, but I left two to three days early, so I left April 11th. So I got a BBL lipo in my back flanks. I had a lot of back flanks back there, and I lipo in the front, I believe, too, in muscle repair. I wanted to get a breast lift as well, but I wasn't able to do that because it's like a hit and miss with Dr. Cabral with his breasts. So I just, you know, I wasn't chancing it. Like, once I got down there and I seen some of the girls in clinic, their breasts was a little bit way too high. So I'ma just wait until like my 6 month mark to go ahead and get a breast lift. But I'll start off by talking about, let me see. Oh, this is important. I'm gonna start talking about this first. Get a good recovery house. Like, make sure you guys find a good recovery house that you guys are going to. Like, I know it's kind of hard because a lot of those recovery houses out there, they aren't good. They're all messed up and everything and disorganized. The nurses still, like, and they, the recovery house I was at, they wasn't doing vitals. The food they was giving us, it was like food we weren't even supposed to be eating. And it was just like the nurse aides there, they wasn't like giving us that care that we really need. Like, it was every time me or like any of my roommates or any of the girls in the house was to ring the bell, like, they wouldn't come on time. They would sit here and have attitudes and, you know, just do all that stuff. So make sure you guys like find a good recovery house and do your research. Like, my original recovery house I was supposed to be at was Precious Recovery House. I was supposed to be there originally, but as soon as I got to Dominican Republic, my driver dropped me off straight up at the clinic, and I thought we was going to recovery house to drop, you know, my luggage off, and that was not the case. Like, and it come to find out, like, later on that day, me and three other girls were supposed to go to recovery house as well. So we're just like waiting, like, we're downstairs in the lobby at the clinic, we're waiting. And then, so we finally get in the driver's car, whatever. Then he's like, oh, you guys aren't going to Precious Recovery House. And we're like, what? Like, where are we going then? You know, because we already paid our deposit and everything. Like, my stuff came with the package and everything. So I was like so heated. I ended up contacting Cabral's assistant, and she basically said that the Precious Recovery House was basically overpacked. They booked too many people for that. So that was a mess. Just long story short, make sure you guys like definitely find a good recovery house. Like, even if you're doing an Airbnb, find a good nurse too, because my overnight nurse that I have with me at the clinic, she slept the whole time, and I was up and I was, you know, trying to ask her questions, because, you know, I'm like completely new to this, and like I was just, you know, kind of nervous and everything, and I didn't want to go to sleep. Like, I didn't sleep at all. Like, I think the only time I slept was like 2 hours when I first got there, and I just kept waking up. I couldn't sleep for nothing, and she was on the side of me, sleep on the couch. She was asleep. The only time she got up was to empty my catheter, because she had the little alarm set. But other than that, like, she was just knocked out. So just make sure y'all find a good nurse as well too. Second thing I want to talk about is, I would say, money. TSA, they really, you know, I brung $12,000 down there, and they, you know, they didn't really ask me, like, oh, what is this money for? You know what I mean? Like, because I put it underneath. Like, I don't even know how they even like seen it, but I put it like how my duffel bag was. It was just like a secret pocket, and I had put my money there. But of course, but they saw it, but they didn't even ask or nothing. They let me go through whatever. Then I would say also still bring your vitamins down there. The pills that Cabral, the medication that Cabral prescribed or whatever, after 2 days of taking it, I didn't take it no more. It was making me sick. Like, I had to tell the nurses, nurse aides as well at my recovery house, like, I'm not taking that. Like, it's making me sick. Like, I feel like I'm about to faint. Soon as I like literally stopped taking it, I was fine. My energy rebuild up. I was still taking my vitamins like I was taking before I went to surgery as well. Prior to surgery, like getting prepared for surgery, like beetroot pills. I was taking that, not the recovery house, but these are just the pills that I had started off with, was the beetroot pills and vitamin C, the woman's one a day. I also was getting fresh beets from like Kroger's or Walmart, or like you can get it from your local grocery store. I was getting fresh beets, juicing it, drinking that as well. I was also drinking the Walmart beet juice. Like, it's organic, it doesn't have that much iron, but that helped me a lot too. And I didn't use the Wow iron brand that everybody was talking about to get. I didn't use that. I mean, my hemo level was at a 14.5, so it was good. Like, I made sure I kept up on that for like for sure. My eating habits, I did my own like labs like a month prior for surgery, and I was prescribed medication from my PCP doctor. High cholesterol pills. So she prescribed me with that. That helped me as well with all my lab work. So basically, like, you guys will want to just like please get your labs done before, so you can figure out your levels, so that way when you don't go down there won't be no backtrack of anything or anything holding you behind, or you got to change your date while you're down there because something with your labs didn't work. So make sure you guys do that as well. And I would say, like, I'm doing okay with my care. I still, like, my incisions are closed, my tummy tuck incisions. I use bio oil, and I use the Mederma in the scar away gel and then the scar away sheets just to make my tummy tuck scar fade away. I also use these lymphatic drains. These are really good if you like have lots of fluids. These are really good. I got it from Amazon. I got a lot of these. It really helped me as well. In my state, in my city where I live at, I don't really have like a lot of people down here that does lymphatic massages. So it's really hard. Like, I even wasted so much money, and I should have done my research like before I went to surgery and everything, like before I was getting prepared. I should have done my research. Like, and that's one of the things you guys need to do to make sure you guys area wherever you live at has some like people that actually do lymphatic massages. Like, I done wasted way too many money on, you know, all these places down here in Ohio, Columbus, Ohio, thinking that they do lymphatic massages. And it wasn't lymphatic massages. It was like literally regular massages. So, you know, I'm doing fine with that. My lower back is still like tight. I do wear my boards and foams. And about the massages, I did find a person, and I'm so glad I found her because I need a massage really bad. Like, I've been massaging myself and everything and keeping myself, you know, up to date with my post-op care. But it's just important that you have a professional. Like, it's good to do it yourself. Like, you know, when you get your own equipment from Amazon and everything, you can get it yourself, but it's good to have a professional, like a high-tech professional. So just make sure you guys do your research on that. But my lipo is going, oh, you guys can't really see my lipo. I still get that burning sensation, like that inflammation. I still get that sometimes, like when I stand up and everything. I guess they said that is normal, so I have nothing to worry about that. But let me stand up so you guys can see. And I'm gonna show before and after pictures at the end. I had got, he gave me laps and I think a little bit of hips as well. My laps, they was like up here. So I wanted it to be a little bit more, but you know, my swollen, shrinking, it went down. So, you know, I don't know if you guys can really see. So I've got a BBL, my waist is small, and like I said, like my back flanks, he lipoed it and it was super bad. I had it like right back to back. So it was like that. But yeah, I kind of like my results. Well, I do like my results. I am wanting to go to a round two. Not with him, but with Delsa, you know, because she does good breasts. So I was going to do that. But as far as round two for like a BBL, I don't know where they will get the fat from, because like Cabral like snatched every inch of fat from me. So I don't know like where they will even get the fat from. But I mean, he told me like he found fat in places that I didn't know I had fat at. So my stats. Okay, so I'm 5'3", and before I went to surgery, I was 173. After surgery, like when I came home and everything, I lost a lot of weight. Like I wasn't in the 170s at all. I came back 145. Like when I came home, I lost a lot of weight. So it was just like my thighs is the most area where I get like gain weight in, as well as my stomach. But I lost a lot of weight, and as of now, I did gain a little bit. I'm 156 now, but that's, you know, that wasn't where I was at, but it's fine. I mean, I like it, small boutique, you know. So you guys just make sure you guys like catch up on you guys' post op care. Like that's really most important. Like that's really 100% important. Like, so like the whole point of me doing this video was to, you know, tell you guys about the whole experience. And I will say, like, at the clinic, Cabral's clinic, it is super busy. I would say you need to get there as early as you can. You know, when I first got dropped off there, I had to basically, you know, give them ID, passport, give them all that, sign all that papers. Then I was scheduled for labs. And then, like, the next day I saw the anesthesia person. And it's just, my blood drawn as well. I did my blood drawn first, and then I saw the anesthesia person. So it's just, it can get crazy on some days. I mean, I went around the busiest time, of course, when it's tax season and everybody has their money. I went around that time around April, so I don't know about how it is now, but it was busy. I would say get there as early as you can. I mean, me and my roommate, we every day until our, because we had the same surgery today, until our surgery day, we was going there early. And you know, there was a few girls there, but it can get crowded, it can get disorganized, and you will have to wait. So my stay there, I only stayed, I believe, 10 days. And I know you're supposed to stay 14 through 20, I believe, but I stayed 10 days because of the shitty recovery house that I was at. I didn't like how they was treating us. I had to leave early, and I was fine with it because, you know, I know how to do most of the things that they was doing anyways. I did get my drains out as well. I didn't fly with my drains because, like, I was draining really fine. Like, it wasn't red anymore. It was, you know, turning that yellowish, pinkish color. And I asked my massage lady down there if I was able to take the drains out, if it was, you know, safe and healthy for me. And she said it was fine because I didn't really even have anything down there. So I would say, Cabral's assistant, she had took out my back drains. And then the next day, the day of my that I had to leave for the airport, my massage lady took out my front drains. So I was fine. I didn't fly home with any drains. And even though you're supposed to keep them in, I mean, I was fine when I went home. I was fine. Like, the stuff I was doing, I know how to do. Anyways, like, for me working in the nurse criteria. So, I mean, yeah, that's all really I gotta say for real. If you guys have any questions, comments, or want me to answer anything else, you guys can just, I would say, like, write me right underneath the comments. I will do a whole another video of questions and answers that I've been through. This is just the brief summary of my whole experience down there. And I would say I want to talk about this too. This is the last topic. When I went into surgery or whatever, mind you, like, I got there at 7. Got there at 7 in the morning, and I didn't get into surgery until literally like 11:20 something at night. So they gave me the blue pill. You know, I was still up. That didn't do anything to me. I guess that's supposed to make you relax and everything. That didn't do anything to me. So they gave me the IV, which I believe is the epidural or whatever. That didn't work either, because I remember my whole time being up in surgery, from me being wheeled down to the surgery room, from me getting flipped back and forth on the table. Like, I was up the whole time, and the anesthesia person, he just kept like trying to close my eyelids and tell me to go to sleep. He was like, sleep, sleep. And I was like, I'm not tired. Like, I was up talking the whole time. Like, and as far as like feeling anything, I didn't feel nothing. The only thing that I did feel a little bit was the tugging with the muscle repair. And I just remember me, you know, asking the anesthesia guy, like, are you guys done yet? Are you guys done yet? So I was up the whole time. Like, I wasn't scared of nothing. I did not fall asleep. I don't know why. Like, I didn't fall asleep. Most girls, they fall asleep once that IV's in, and once they take the blue pill. But I was up. I didn't even wake up during surgery, because I was up the whole time. So it was just like, I remember the whole experience. You know, I wasn't really as much scared, because it just reminded me of when I got C-sections. I got three C-sections, and I was up the whole time. And like, how they do that with the process is basically how they, you know, how they do it, like, keep you up. So I don't know, like, it just, I was just comfortable with it, because I, you know, been up with prior surgeries before. But I mean, I was safe, you know. He just kept trying to tell me to go to sleep, and I was just like, no, I'm up. So yeah, but if you guys have any questions, I can answer anything about, you know, recovery houses, nurses, post-op care supplies, or just anything, you guys can let me know. But that's you guys who are watching. Thank you. Go, babies, go, babies, go, babies.